All right, this is kind of action-packed, so let's get started. So far, I think you've gotten a lot of details as I look through the curriculum, the agenda. This talk is going to step way back and way up and kind of look down at software through the application. So, and the basic focus of this talk is looking top-down, how do we develop parallel software? So I'm going to start out with a few assumptions that I have about how not to develop parallel software. And the first of those is it's very common to take some initial code, your legacy code, you profile it, you look at your performance profile. If it's not fast enough, then you just sit down with your own human intelligence. You know, maybe you've taken the, you know, some courses on pthreads, using pthreads or something. Scratch your head, try and recode with more threads, run the profile again, iterate through this. And hopefully at some point it's fast enough. If so, then you go ahead and ship it. Now, you may think that this is a straw man, that this is just something some academic is standing up there and talking about. No, if you give Intel enough money and say, well, we bought all these parallel processors, but they're not fast enough, they'll ship you out an application engineer, and this is exactly what they'll tell you to do. So what's wrong with this? Well, it's very common. You don't go to conferences and hear talks about this, but it's very common to go through this whole process and have your end processor version run slower than your sequential processor. So here's a true-life example. Here's a series of standard electronic design automation benchmarks. Here's using serial two threads up to six threads, and what you'll see is that the things actually get uniformly slower with more parallel processors. And again, you know, basically, honestly, I kind of judge the experience of how experienced my audience is when I'm talking about is to see how many like, I know how that goes, right? Okay, so what's an alternative? This is a little bit of a straw man, although it wasn't when I first presented this slide. This is the supercompiler solution. So you take that same code, and we've got a supercompiler that will automatically parallelize this. And if it doesn't go quite fast enough for you, well, don't worry. You don't have to touch your code. We're going to tune up the compiler and run through here and eventually be fast enough. And the problem is, and this is actually me quoting Tim Mattson, who you've heard a couple times, I think you'll hear him one more in this agenda, is that 30 years of research on high-performance computing don't offer much hope here. And here's a reasonably representative slide about high-performance computing. And yeah, in fact, you can, you know, often with automatic compilation techniques get a 20% speed up. But relative to what you can do by hand, that's leaving an awful lot of performance on the table. So what's another kind of contender for how to do parallel programming is, let's try a new language. We have a language for you. You use this, you're going to, you know, really get some mileage out of your parallel programming. So you code up, and the best of those don't require you to completely recode your legacy code. You just recode portions. So code in some of the new language, profile, performance profile. Oh, well, wasn't quite fast enough. Okay, well, you just need to recode more portions. So that's what you need. So pretty soon, you're recoding your entire application, and the problem is we're at 200 parallel programming languages and growing, and if any of those actually worked like this, you'd have heard about it by now, right? That's a fact. And when I throw out this number 200, people go, okay, that sounds, again, kind of exaggeration. Actually, in fact, here's, again, Tim Mattson put this list together, and usually the response is in an academic environment when you put this up is like, it's not people go, oh, 200, that's ridiculous. It's like, oh, 200, well, wait a minute, well, where's my language on there? I did my dissertation on parallel programming language. I don't see it on there. So in fact, it's 200 and growing as we speak. Okay, so it'd be pretty depressing if I set all that up and I didn't have any answers for you. So I do think that there's an alternative, and when I get the alternative, not many of you, I think, know me, you know, as I look out there. But I'm a pretty pragmatic person, and I look back. I spent 15 years in industry. At one point, I was overseeing the shipping of, overseeing the technology as chief technical officer of a company that shipped 25 software products, about 25 million lines of code. And my best design principle in developing software is modularity. So again, this is kind of an industrial perspective, but if I look at it from the architect, modularity allows kind of a sensible, intelligent design. You can draw on a whiteboard, somebody understands it. As a project manager, I think it's offers a lot of comfort. You take those modules in however big your group is, you can deal them out to the programmers in your group. Then once you've dealt them out, you can track development. You've got your PERT chart that shows how all these modules come together to build the software. And you know, as the project goes along, you know, what you're most concerned about is your software quality and what the bug reports look like. And you can kind of build a control panel for that and just look at outstanding bug reports by module as well as by system integration. If you see one module's really got a lot of bugs, then you begin to understand, track down, okay, that's why we're having system integration problems. Now, as an individual contributor, and for the youngsters in the group, that's probably where you'll be at least for some time, what this means is that you, with good modularity, you can focus on the module you're implementing without worrying about what's going on in the rest of the group. The manager and the architect, their job is to kind of carve things up so that you can focus on what you want to do. Also, as I'll be talking about later, modularity helps us to identify key computations. Now, when I first started kind of running this past my own graduate students, they go, what's the alternative exactly? I mean, I'm not sure what you're getting at. So basically, let me tell you, since I've lived it, what life is like without modularity. If you're trying to understand somebody's code, you're looking at spaghetti code, you at any given time in the project, I mean, you may have a complete war over interpretation of the specification where, wait a minute, you know, so you have a lot of interdependencies. If you don't have modularity, what's the alternative? You have interdependencies, and so there's a lot of, wait a minute, I developed on my code under this interpretation. No, that's clearly not right. Let's go back and look at the actual specification. It should be another way. Or your code is so tangled up, you just go, look, I'm just going to have to wait till that settles down. I'm going to take the afternoon off. You tell me when your code is finally settled. This is my least favorite. You're in the office till 11 o'clock, finally got your code done, did it the best you could in terms of unit testing, driving home. Thank God they didn't have cell phones when I was doing individual contributor, because, you know, but you do. You get all the way home, you notice the answering machine's blinking. You're just afraid to pick it up. We're trying to do the nightly build and your code broke. I'm like going, it worked 15 minutes ago, but I noticed there was still someone in the office coding away. Something tells me it's their problem, not my problem, right? But again, so what does that turn into? That turns into wars over the interpretation of specification. It's very hard to verify your code in isolation, and this is, I think, a really key point from the performance programming standpoint is, therefore, it's very hard to optimize. Because you can't build a little sandbox and just optimize your code because you're always interfacing with everyone else's code. And, of course, when it's hard to optimize, it's hard to parallelize. And it's hard to parallelize without identifying the key computations. Okay, so modularity is what we need. And this is not a new idea. This is over 40 years old. This is kind of the pivotal paper in the history. Okay. So modularity is important, but in particular for parallel programming, it's not quite enough. So I'd like to do a quick pop quiz here. Okay, want to see a... Okay, so while... try and hold your enthusiasm a little bit here. We're going to ask the whole group here, is software more like A, a building, or B, a factory? How many people think it's more like A, a building? Okay, I'd say that's about half the group. And how many think it's more like B, a factory? I'd say with the many dissenters, that's actually less than the group. Okay. Now note that a factory is in fact a building. So you, sir, you said it's more like a building. Would you like to, you know, share your viewpoint on that? Start out with a foundation, build up. That sounds good. Yeah, a building is certainly modular. I mean, this is the metaphor of object-oriented programming, right? Okay, and I think the gentleman who said it's like a factory just got disgusted and laughed off. Okay, who else would... Who else wants to say it's like a, tell me why they think it's like a factory? You. So depends on how you think about it. Well, again, so let me make sure this is a software in operation. So software in operation kind of reflects software as it's coded up. But I have a lot of empathy with the view that software is more like a building, because that's what I taught in software engineering courses here for about a decade. But the more I started to think about it, the more I thought, well, wait a minute. Buildings kind of sit there like a brick, right? They just kind of house something. You know, software takes an input, warehouses intermediate results, produces output. I claim software is a lot more like a factory in that regard. So we're going to explore that idea some more in these next slides. But first, I want to say that the nuance here is that what computations we do is as important as how we do them. When you go through the whole contemporary software engineering curriculum and learn a lot about object-oriented programming, there's a lot of talk about how you put code together, not a lot of talk about what the code actually does. And this is kind of swinging the pendulum back that, boy, what the code does is just as important as how we put it together. So these are our computational patterns. I'll talk more about them in just a moment. Basically, all we need to understand right now is that there are 13 of them. These are our building blocks of computation. Okay, so if you remember, this is all the answer of how do I think you should build parallel programming. So I think the key to parallel programming is developing a good software architecture. That software architecture is hierarchical. It's a composition of these computations, which I kind of think of as like the atoms of out of which you're building your molecules, or the machinery of your factory. The structural patterns are like the molecular bonds, how you put atoms together, or the layout of the factory, right? And so software architecture naturally gives you modularity through these structural patterns, which has those benefits which I just described. You can manage, you can implement, you can verify. And then this focus on the computations gives you the actual efficiency, which is why you're particularly interested in parallel programming. Okay, so, you know, we'll hit the gavel there for now. You know, you don't have to believe this yet. I'll be going into more detail. So you notice I use the word patterns, and I just want to spend a minute so that this isn't left abstract. Pattern is a pretty simple idea. How many of you know the Gang of Four design patterns? Okay, all right, good thing I'm taking it from the top then. Okay, this all goes back to a professor at University of California, Berkeley, in the civil architecture group. He was actually an architect, talking about how you build buildings. And he says a pattern just describes a problem which occurs over and over, and then a solution is described in such a way that you can use that solution in a million different ways without doing the same thing twice. Or I would just say it's a generalizable solution to a recurring problem. So that's a pattern. And in his book, A Pattern Language, Alexander described 253 patterns which describe how all the way from if you were to parachute and kind of terraform a new Earth for the first time, how would you organize towns there, all the way down to very, very detailed architectural elements like a roof cap, right? And so to go from that very high level of how do you arrange your towns to that very low level of where do you put the roof cap, then that's called the pattern language. It's an organized way of putting these patterns together. Now, this has influenced computer science thinking a lot. It does have the natural limitation that this is all talking about civil architecture, not software architecture. Okay, but we're going to use it as an inspiration. And so let me just go in a little more detail. Again, there are 253 patterns. And to give you a sense of how these combine, so at a particular kind of step, when we're looking at how do we want to arrange a group of buildings, say on a college campus or a shopping mall, okay? So he has about 10 patterns that kind of inform your thinking, questions you think about when you're actually making those decisions. So one of those patterns is family of entrances. And basically, this is getting to the problem, which we've all happened in, which is you show up maybe on the Berkeley campus. You haven't been here before. You see a lot of buildings and so forth. You have really no idea where to begin unless you see a map. And so where do you go? And the solution is, you know, and this is a little sketch from his book, is can't we lay things out so that in a natural point of entrance here, you can kind of survey things, survey the entrances to form a family so you can quickly scan around. Oh, SDH, that must be it right there. Okay, so here's a little more graphical or a little more dimensional view of that little picture. Right? So that's the notion. Now, these are not, you know, mathematical formalisms. You didn't see any algebra, no logic there or anything. These are a very kind of high-level way that humans think about solving problems. And so, as opposed to some of the other, little mini elements of this course, which are all important pieces of the problem, this is looking at how you put them all together to solve a total programming problem. And my statement up front is that that's a human process, right? And so we're going to use a style of thinking, you know, that's oriented towards humans, not computers. Okay, so those of you who know the Gang of Four patterns, this has kind of been already ironed out in object-oriented programming. The advantages are kind of seen. First of all, patterns give a name to things. So when one programmer talks to another and says, I'm using MapReduce, that communicates a huge amount of information in just that name from one programmer to another. When you have a portion of your program, you say the computational approach that I'm taking to this is MapReduce. That gives a huge amount of information to someone trying to maintain that code. For beginners in software engineering, and it's easy at my age to kind of go, yeah, the first 5 or 6 years, you know, of solid programming, you know, maybe some of you fall within that. I think what's great here is it gives a palette of choices. When you first start programming, you know, you're going, I don't know, how should I approach this? What's the right way to approach this? Well, this gives you a palette. On the other hand, for the veterans, you know, one challenge of, you know, after some years of programming is go, how do I know I did it right? Did I really explore all the natural alternatives? So the fact that we have a finite set of patterns means that, one, beginners get to try all those and look over, and veterans kind of go, well, you know, I looked at 8 different ways of doing it. I think that's about it. These give a natural abstraction about how to think about design. Again, back to the MapReduce, that's a big decision about how to parallelize your program, right? And so it communicates that very succinctly. Associated with that decision of, say, MapReduce, there's a bunch of particular good design practices of how you do it. And we can, you know, you can go and read a chapter on MapReduce, and that will distill and disseminate the experience of people who've used MapReduce before. If you're coming up, you know, either you've been kind of put on the maintenance crew of software, or you've been told to go, you know, this code is just getting old and it's broken, and it's time to restructure a new factor, then patterns really help you to understand the interrelatedness and give you some additional flexibility in how to approach that. Okay, so now we're going to get down to brass tacks, and I'm going to talk about, okay, how do we actually do this? Okay, so the first step most commonly is to identify the software structure. So what I have here are 9 particular structural patterns. These are basic ways of putting software together and composing it. And I kind of think of this as going back to our factory analogy. This is how you lay out your factory plant. Right? Then there are the key computations. So let's spend just a couple minutes more than before here. So these are our 13 key types of computation. We're going to break the whole world of all types of computation, not in individual algorithms, which is relatively low level, but to general strategies of how do we approach solving that computational class. Now, we didn't just pull this out of our hat. We did get a good start with 7 patterns of 7 computational patterns of high-performance computing here. So what these are across the top here are entire domains of computation, entire domains of maybe better application areas, like computer design where I grew up. These are spec benchmark, embedded systems, databases, and so forth. If we see red here, as we see red in the high-performance column here, it means that that pattern shows up a lot in that area. If we see kind of the orangish one here, it means it shows up pretty much, more so. Green is less, and blue means it hardly shows up there at all. And what we can see is across these range of different application areas, things are pretty diverse. These patterns show up a lot in high-performance computing. They hardly show up at all in database programming, by contrast. Right? So these are the key computations, and in my factory, these are like my machinery. This is the machinery that really does the work, which is, this is kind of the step of going beyond just looking at object-oriented programming. This is looking at, you know, what actually happens in all those little modules. And then we put it all together. This is like a layout of a simple manufacturing plant. This is a, you know, kind of anatomically correct architecture of an actual software application. Now, honestly, the day that I kind of had this aha, software is more like a factory, I made a rare trip over to the engineering library because I didn't know exactly how to kind of Google around to get this, and I looked at books on how do you build a factory. And I was amazed to find that exactly the kind of things that we think about in doing parallel computing, scheduling, what's the latency, how do we examine throughput, how do we do workflow. Workflow is kind of an interesting because that's not something we often talk about in, say, parallel computing. But when we use that analogy back into parallel computing, it's really saying how does data flow through the factory of the program? How do we arrange things so it flows efficiently? How do we do resource management, capacity? You know, things like how big should a work cell be? How big should a work cell be in a factory is kind of analogous to what question we face every day as programmers when we're sitting down to do some software. It means what's about the right size of a module? Okay, if it gets too big, maybe cumbersome to maintain, maybe very complicated in terms of I/O and so forth. Gets too small, it's maybe breaking the problem down to find a level of granularity, right? So I was pretty pleased with the analogy, given how much the concerns of building a factory are precisely the concerns of doing a parallel program. Okay, so going to get in the details here a little bit, just to give you a flavor. First, some terminology. So components are where all the computation happens. There are these little boxes here. It can be hierarchical, so you notice this box has boxes inside it. Connectors are where the communication happens. And a configuration is just an assembly of components and connectors. You know, if we want to get formal about it, we could describe it as a family of graphs, right? So these are our structural patterns. You know, I claim you can build arbitrarily complex software out of this, and more strongly, I claim you can build any software out of these just structural patterns. Now, as soon as you see these, as you get to know them a little bit, people, you know, kind of first question is, oh, gosh, you know, is a model view controller really kind of pipe and filter and so forth? Okay, that's absolutely true. But the analogy I finally used to do that is that when you are trying to fix your plumbing, you're really happy you have a pipe wrench. You could go, oh, isn't a crescent wrench basically, isn't a pipe wrench a crescent wrench? Couldn't you use a crescent wrench for this job? Yes, you could. That's not the tool I want to use. In a similar way, as a software programmer, as a software architect, this is your palette of ways to structure things together. It's not a mathematical formalism of the minimal that you need. These are about the level of tool, a manageable tool set. You know, if I'm thinking about the high-level structure of my software, I may think about, okay, how do I... which one of these is the natural way to structure my code and kind of examine them one by one. Okay, I'm going to focus on just three of these just to give you a flavor for this. Okay? So pipe and filter, everybody's favorite. Filters are where the computation happens. Filters have no state. They see no global state. They get input. They produce output. Right? So what's an example of pipe and filter? Somebody give me an example of pipe and filter. Analyzing, sure, okay. Signals go in, analysis goes out. Any others? Code used every day? Yes, sir.
Audio?
Sure. Yeah, I'm agreeable. Basically, almost every software program has pipe and filter at the highest level. Right? I mean, we're going to use hierarchy. It takes some input, produces some output. If you think about a factory, everyone, it's kind of like a series of stages and so forth. And so here's one we see very early in life, a compiler scanning the program, builds some internal representation, optimize, and so forth. Here's an image retrieval system I'll be talking about later. Here's a logic optimizer, a piece of code that I worked on for a number, at least several years of my life. Okay, pipe and filter. That's it, pretty much. Okay, iterator pattern. So in parallelism, this is not just a loop, right? What's relevant here is we have some initialization condition. Then we have a whole bunch of stuff that may be locally kind of synchronized or locally have dependencies, but globally is pretty independent. And then we synchronize the conditions. We typically have some exit condition. You can kind of think of it as a loop variable if you want to. Have we met that? No. Then we iterate some more. Yes, we go on. It can be a loop variable or it can be something more complicated. So examples of that are a for loop. Anything with a for loop certainly is a simple example. If we're kind of scaling up in software architecture a little bit more, typically it's the folks from the science side of the fence who come in and say, huh, anyone? Anything at all? Yes, sir. Convergence. Convergence to some optimum, for example, right? So any kind of optimization will look like this. So here's, again, this is an example we're going to use later in support vector machine training where basically we're iterating through, we're updating the surface, we're seeing how far our data points from that surface. You can kind of think of that as an error condition. If it's within bounds, fine. Within some acceptable error, fine. We can stop there. Otherwise, we better keep perturbing the surface. Fractal computation, yeah, sure. Anything where you just keep going until you know that you're done, right? But you may know a priori when you're done, when you will be done by some fixed iterations, or you may need to wait until some condition that's only computed in here is met. Okay. Structural pattern number 3, MapReduce. Okay, so MapReduce, certainly Google made it famous, but it goes back to early days of Lisp programming, right? In which you simply map an arbitrary function onto some independent data sets, and the fact that these data sets are independent is pretty important, and then you reduce it down to some result. Okay, MapReduce examples. For example, yeah, I mean, it's famous at Google because it's the workhorse at Google, right? I mean, you know, if you're looking for, you know, computing page ranks, or if you're looking for just the number one search term or something like that. Yeah, another answer? Dictionary tag against passwords. Sure. You have a bunch of independent data, you have a map of function on, and then you reduce down to get the result. Okay? So again, I'm using the support vector machine example, because I'll go into detail later. But so earlier we were trying to see what's the error relative to this fence frontier that we're building. So we want to know how far off from that you are and are you on the right side of the fence. Okay. That computation is computed on all the data points in the N space simultaneously. And then you reduce down to see those that are not within the error bound, right? Okay, so that's map reduce. Not exactly a web application there. Okay, those are your structural patterns. What's the takeaway? The takeaway is to begin to contemplate, do I believe that all the software I will ever build or look at could be developed just using 8 or 9 different ways of structuring code in a highly modular fashion, right? And in particular, in these 8 or 9 ways. Okay, next are computational patterns. Now, I always, you know, I think this is the first year I presented this that I'm kind of relaxed, right? You know, because there's, you know, we're talking about broad fields here. Let's start with linear algebra. Okay, sorry, first let's review these, put these 3 in context. So these are our 13. These are the 3 that we're looking at. Okay, linear algebra is vast, you know. I've got about 2 minutes to say something about it. Finally, I go, well, that's the point. That's the whole point of it. That's why I'm here talking about it, not Jim Dummel, which is at this level of thinking about how to build software, all you're trying to identify is fundamentally, what kind of computation or computations am I doing? You look at linear algebra, and if it's what, you know, oh, I guess it's linear algebra. If it's a vector or a matrix, you know, you probably have a linear algebra problem. Okay, so there's the basic linear algebra subroutines here. We've got vector, 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 matrix, and matrix, matrix, right? That's at this level. Doesn't mean Jim hasn't spent a wonderful career puzzling through all this stuff, but when you're top-down trying to architect this, this is really, truly all that I'm asking you to know is what kind of computation I'm doing. Once I know what kind of computation I'm doing, what can I do? Well, I've got a lot of help. There are books, there are big software packages, there are experts I can turn to, right? Experts like Jim here, right? There's lots of things I can reel in. If I don't do that simple identification, then I think there's two mistakes we do. One is like, oh my gosh, what do I do? And the other is, well, let me just go in there and code matrix multiply myself. Okay? Both of those, you know, the second one will at least get the job done, but it's not going to get the job done efficiently. We want to draw on the fact that people know a lot about this computation, the kind of computation I'm doing right now. Okay, here's another one. This is from our own experience. We did some work on MRI image reconstruction. We're trying to do this fast enough that people can get their MRI scans, even though in some compressed sensing format, out in real time. So right now, kids are going through Lucile Packard Hospital through much diminished scan time because we developed, with Mickey Lustig, algorithms and implementations to do this reconstruction very quickly. What's the bottom line? What's the 35,000-foot view? Is basically we're just changing the state space using Fourier and wavelet representations, right? It looks kind of like this stuff, FFTs and so forth. That's about the level that we get started. That's about the level to begin to know, oh, people know a lot about this stuff. We should go in and say, understand the computations and how to parallelize them. And sure enough, there are large software frameworks like FFTW and Spiral, which have approaches to parallelism and auto-tuners for fast Fourier transform on a variety of different platforms. Okay. Then last, dynamic programming. So when do you know you've got dynamic programming? Well, it obeys this very simple principle of optimality, in which the optimal solution can be built up from optimal solutions to subproblems. It's a very specific characteristic. You know, when you get to the optimal, trying to get the optimal solution of a bunch of subproblems, it's not always the case that all you need to do is look through and do a little scratchpad computation on all your subproblems. Sometimes you have to look for some sort of global property that's not present in any of the local ones. But if this happens to be true, then this has its own particular computational class, which we call dynamic programming. So where I encountered this is in tree covering. This is a tree kind of on its side. We're trying to find the least cost tree cover at its root. And basically, that's going to be the covers that I have at the root, plus the covers of all the subtrees that induces. Okay, so when I try to cover with P, I build up my solution from the best solution for X, the best solution for Y, the best solution for Z. When I try to cover here, I just build up from the best solutions for P and Z. Okay, here's one application which I applied in my former life, which is given a circuit like this. I want to put it efficiently into an actual manufacturable library like that. So how do I do that? First, I build up all the different ways I could cover this base subject tree here of the circuit with these different pieces of circuitry. And then I use dynamic programming in a way similar to what I just described to find the least cost match. Here, in fact, we see this matching, and these are costs computed at the root, is nearly half what this match is. So there's a lot on the table when I can apply this. All right. Here's another example, which is going on behind your software, whether you know or not, which is trying to, given a tree, an abstract syntax tree of a simple computation to be formed, how do we actually generate the code from the compiler that actually runs in your machine? Again, dynamic programming will do that for you. Okay. What's the takeaway? Can I build up the global optimum out of optimum solutions to all the subproblems. That's it. If it has that characteristic, fine. If it's not obvious how to apply it, go ask someone who knows better. There's more known. Here's another application we use, which is in speech recognition, finding the best match in some speech observation, recognize speech or recognize speech. Okay, so those were three computational patterns. Okay, there are 13 of them. What we're trying, our approach to software, building parallel software, is to get people familiar with those 13, and then how to decide is this problem or which of these computations occur, and then understand how can we go get more information about how to implement those efficiently. Okay, so this is a good point to pause for questions. Any questions so far? Please.
Listening to your talk, I came out of network programming for multiple decades. The patterns we use there are actually not very many of those. Are those kind of, for example, client server? That's a pattern that did not list. Other patterns are datagram, connection oriented streams.
Right.
And when I say those words, someone who's an expert in those areas.
Yeah. No, it's a great question. So basically, the question is, well, wait a minute. I didn't just arrive on a train. I'm an experienced programmer. I worked for years doing programming, and the patterns that you showed, that's all fine. But those are not the level patterns that I use. So these are the core computations. So what we found is when we go and do computer vision, when we go to do speech recognition, if we want to do network applications, there's a whole kind of what we call them application patterns on top of that, right? Which describe the basic, very meaningful, and just as you say, they are patterns, and I'm gratified that you use that term for something like that, because they are indeed patterns which have all the advantage patterns. They convey a lot of information and so forth. But if you go down and you just watched a parallel architecture cranking away, or you looked at the actual kind of low-level code, you look at a page of it, you're not going to go client-server, right? The core computations that are going on in something like network applications are things like finite state machine, if I'm doing some error correction or encryptions, what we call the circuits patterns and so forth, those are the core computations. And so you've got an excellent and very practical point that there's a whole kind of another level industry on top of this, which some of my students are exploring of, okay, what level patterns do we need to describe so they kind of meet naturally the application developer, right? But still, that doesn't negate the fact that, this is a little bit, we're not teaching, we're kind of teaching you need to know how to do long division. We're not teaching, at the hexadecimal level, and we're not teaching, encryption, but we're teaching the core computations that you can break something like a network application down to. So thanks for sharing that concern. Other questions before I move on? Okay, let me catch up here. That's a great question. Thank you. Sure, no other questions? No other great questions? I'm always happy to get to. I have a new version of PowerPoint here. I'm just terrified to go into slide sorter mode and try to advance here. Okay. All right, so now we're going to go through a couple particular applications here and show how you put these ideas together. So one is a support vector machine. So my former student and now colleague, Brian Consaro, just walked in. So his wife has a lot of pictures of flowers and a lot of pictures of kids, right? And he would sure like to be able to just automatically partition those into these are the folders with flowers, these are the folders with kids. So the way that you do that is you choose some examples, you train a classifier, and so you kind of imagine that you extract features out of that in some n space, you kind of build a fence to separate These are flowers. These are children. And then when you get new images in, continuously poured in, then you go through this process and you actually exercise your classifier and hopefully get the results you want in terms of that partition. If not, with user feedback, you can go in and continue to train your classifier. Okay? So at the top level, this software has what pattern? What structural pattern? Pipe and filter, indeed. So, but this is not enough detail for us really to do implementation, so we're going to keep going lower into that. So here's the higher level pipe and filter architecture, and we're going to go into more detail on something like just the feature extractor. So I won't go a lot into the computational details, of either the details of the algorithm or the computational details, but basically at the level of architecting this, we build a scale space representation of that, which uses the structured grid pattern. We select points of interest in supporting regions that will be useful in classification. We do that using MapReduce, which has, at the very low level, dense linear algebra. And then we build descriptors, which, again, is MapReduce and structured grid. Okay? And this is actually published as an independent paper. And so that's all at this little box. Now, you notice we did go through a couple layers of hierarchy, but that's all we really went through, right? And we kind of feel that we're done when we've got it down to one of those familiar computational patterns, because if we're stuck on how to do this, dense linear algebra computation, and actually this is a very simple one, but if it was more complicated, then we know where to go in terms of reeling in some more sophistication in doing that computation. Okay, looking at the next step, how we actually train our classifier. So I already went through this in terms of, this is an example of the which structural pattern? Iterator, right? This was our example. So kind of imagine that we're updating the optimality conditions, and then we're selecting a working set and solving the quadratic program. Or intuitively, what we're doing is we're stitching together the fence that will serve to classify either flowers or children as we build or train our classifier. And these are basically, inside of this iterator, we have, what's this? Pipe and filter. Inside this, each of these filters, we just have simple MapReduce computations. Okay? And then exercising the classifier, well, that's a lot easier. We just have a very simple filter here in which we compute dot products, which is a simple dense linear algebra computation, and then we go and compute these kernel values, sum it, and scale it, and basically determine which side of the fence did we land on. Okay? We do that, we're able to apply MapReduce because these are independent data sets. Right? That's exercising a classifier. Okay, and so this was a very successful application. We got range for the training portion, 9 to 35x speed up for the training, even faster speed ups for classifications. This code has 2,900 downloads last time I looked. And Brian, happy to say, I looked today and we now reach 200 citations on it. This is the currency for academic research. You know, this is what academics sit around and kind of hoard and count and so forth. And these are 200 citations to this paper. Now the relevant point there is, this is a real application. It's a little kind of, you know, key kernel in machine learning. It's real software that was downloaded, and it really does have the software architecture, which I described to you. So it gives you some real sense of, that's about the level of detail when I talk about architecting parallel software. That's about the level of detail that I'm talking about. Okay, let's go a little more slowly through speech recognition and see if I can't get you all on board on how we actually do this. Okay, so at the top level, this is a system description. This is not an architecture. This is kind of a system description. Speech recognition, voice goes in, words come out. There's a first step of a signal processing module where we break it down to speech features, not so different from the kind of notion of building feature vectors in computer vision. Then we have this core recognition network where we do the actual inference to determine what the sequence of words is. So this is what we're going to focus on parallelizing. And so suppose we walk in and we really don't know where to begin, we have some questions to start with. Maybe the basic software structure is immediately apparent to us. And one natural place to begin is basically, you know, somebody, some textbook, some something, some, you know, you Google it, has some block diagram of that process. And that's usually not a bad place to begin in terms of identifying the software structure. Or alternatively, we may, as an expert in that area, go, look, really, I know what the key computation is here. Let me just go in and start looking and see how that happens, and then let's build the structure around that. There are two radically different approaches. So let's say we're looking at the software structure. And let's say we've got a specification document, right? Or at least a high-level specification document. And it's saying, well, this recognition engine that we're building, it's a process of graph traversal and dynamic programming, and each time step, we need to identify the likely states, and from these set of active states, we're going to compute the next state. So basically, we're traversing through a state space frontier to try to arrive at a state which is our maximally likely speech that we actually heard. So just from this description as we had, you know, maybe you know something about this problem, maybe you don't, what would you say the structural pattern is? So where do you focus in on iterative refinement? Yeah, well, there's a great tip right here, each time step, and sure enough, iterative refinement. And that's great. I mean, this is what warms my heart. You know, you didn't know this when you walked in here, right? But already we're beginning to see the simple, but you know, kind of have to look at things the right way style of thinking and looking at these problems to understand what's the basic structure that I'm going to apply to it. Okay, so you can look at this problem as essentially an iterator, as we're iterating through the state space over a hidden Markov model. Right? Okay, so let's go into the details of that. Now it looks kind of complicated. Here are the states in our state space. Here's a sequence of observations. This is the basic sounds as they occur over time. We step forward in time. As we hear more sounds, we get a particular observation, and we try and determine what are the likely next states. The way we compute that is we're saying, what are the probability that I'm in this state? What's the probability if I'm in this state, I go to that state? And what's the probability based on this observation that I go to that state? I do that computation over all the frontier states, and I choose the maximally likely ones. And that's expressed right here. Okay, so let's look at the architecture of that. Okay, so at the top level, we have this iterator over a simple pipe and filter. This is a kind of housekeeping step of getting all my data together. This is this probability computation, and then this is the actual finding the maximum likely states. Okay, so these are our set of structural patterns. You can see the pipe and filter, and now we're going to go into detail on each of the individual filter elements, and I'm going to kind of coax you along here. Okay, so first step is we need to gather and coalesce all these different operands for each state. And the reason we're doing that is we're doing parallel computing, and parallel computing, when you get very disjoint data, it gets much more efficient when you get it all in one place. Okay? So, structural pattern. To do that gather operation, what's your sense of what that looks like? So I'm going to take a stab. All right. Maybe a little abstract. It's MapReduce. There you go. Okay. Sorry. Should I give you a little more time? Okay, we're just basically getting all these distinct data pointed together and reducing down to some coalesced. Okay, and just to remind you, we map each computation and then we reduce it together. That's MapReduce. Okay, next one. So now let's look at this particular computation, the Gaussian mixture model probability, the probability that this, given this feature frame, about 10 milliseconds of speech, we are in this particular state or phone. Okay, so we have this computation to do over the whole frontier, so it kind of has the characteristic of dare to be great. So if you're running on a sequential computer, you certainly would iterate, right, over each state. But you're on a parallel computer, so you can, here's the hint, the data is distinct. It's disjoint. So you can map, reduce. You can map and reduce. You map that computation out, and you reduce down to get the Gaussian mixture module probability. Okay. Then, putting this all together, we want to compute the probability against all the data sets and reduce to find the maximum likely states. So we have all these different states we reach. We want to find the maximum for each likely path to each state. Find those, and that is map reduce. Wins again. That's right. Okay? And that's really it. So that's it. That is the software architecture. It's not like I'm showing you software architecture, then you come by my lab later and you discover, oh, personal organ says, oh, yeah, that's the tip of the iceberg. Boy, let me tell you, this architecture goes on for pages and pages. Nope, this is it. This is really the architecture. This is about the level. Now, the question is, does that really help? When we first got this 11x speedup relative to Brian's speedups he'd gotten a year or two earlier, like 11x, doesn't sound so great. And we were happy this meant we could actually run faster than real time. However, as time went on, we discovered, as other people began to publish in this area, boy, it's really tough to get 11x speedup. This is because of how disjoint this data is, how much time you spend to do the computation and get back together. That's a really good speedup. Okay, so let me wrap up here. Other interesting results. So, you know, I was looking, you know, I've been giving variants of this talk for almost, well, 4 or 5 years. This is, I guess, my fifth year, fifth time. So that would be 4 years. First started, this is all pretty speculative, right? Over these last years, we've had a lot of success over a very broad range of problems and publishing a very broad range of conferences. Frankly, this is not fully up to date, although I did toss in our later center speech paper. And this approach, what I find kind of talking programmer to programmer is computational power patterns give us a different way of looking at computations. You know, it's like computation used to either kind of go from that big ball, gnarly ball of computation, or go down to a particular algorithm, but there didn't seem to be kind of any organizational principles around the computation. And this helps to disentangle it. And so, you know, Alan Kay says with the right viewpoint, you know, with the right perspective, you can raise your IQ 100 points. I've really found that true over and over. And this is one case. I won't say 100 points, but I certainly say, I honestly feel like I get 20 extra IQ points just by thinking, which one of these 13 computational patterns are using? So computational patterns make me feel smarter. The structural patterns make me feel more organized, which is something I already understood from my years in industry. It's just you drive home feeling a lot better, knowing nobody's just going to check in their code and wipe out my code, right? They might wipe out their own code. They're not. Why? Because our software is nicely modular. So structural patterns make me feel organized. Computational patterns make me feel smarter. Okay, here's some other range of speedups. And again, I think what I want to emphasize here, if I didn't already, is so this is a kind of image reconstruction. This is machine learning. These are other computer vision problems. This is speech. These are computational finance. I don't know a lot about any of this. Moreover, my students who know more, certainly, area by area, they don't know a lot more. But we've been successful in these areas because rather than worrying about option pricing, oh, boy, you know, one more big, thick book to read, we just distill down what's the computation. What's the basic computation? Oh, okay, value at risk. Monte Carlo wrapped around some dense linear algebra. Not really so hard when you start to look at it that way. Okay, so in summary, going back to the top, the key to efficient parallel programming is software architecture. That's a composition of structural patterns. I showed you 3, 7 more. I think that's going to do it for you. Computational patterns, these are where I get my efficiency and allow me to identify the key computations to be parallelized. I showed you 3. 10 more of those will do it for you. Putting these all together allows us to do real applications. In my group, and in the more generally in the Power Lab and now the Aspire Lab, we do real applications. I showed you a couple real ones, really out there working. We have many more, and you can get more detail here. Okay, I have just a few more minutes for questions. Questions? Do you believe it? Yeah. This whole process I wouldn't call algorithm development. I would call it, architecting. That's kind of the term we give to it. And, believe it or not, this is where you start. I can't remember the time other than in a classroom example day one that we went all the way back to the drawing board of what are the tasks? What's the data? Is the data shared? What's the access? How do we group tasks? Is there a natural ordering? Are there dependencies, right? Maybe once in your life you have to do that. Almost always, you, even with kind of a textbook, I'm only 2 weeks into the course, this is going to be my project level, have some idea. I have an idea of what the structure is, or I have an idea of what the key computations are. If you have a key, I showed you how when you just systematically identify the software structure, how that goes. Sometimes you go, it's just Monte Carlo wrapped around this simple formula. That's really all there is to it. Right? Okay, well, that's it. You've identified the key computations, and so then you build out from there. So, I can just say, so I've taught this to undergraduates 4 times now, and, honestly, I would say 70, 80%, basically get on board. What does get on board means? Get on board, pose a problem, put on the exam, and they get the right architecture, right? That's yeah. But it's still very much a human process. Yeah. Yes, sir. You want to wait for the microphone for the folks back home.
Maybe this is somewhat analogous to optimization, but one of the issues that I'm starting to encounter in software is what do you do when, say, somebody inserts some malicious software and it tries to change the behavior? Is there anything in architecture that you might have to change?
The software architecture.
Yeah, it's almost like it's so new. I don't know if there's any real thought.
No, I think, certainly I have a sense that as a very general tool, modularity will help, right? Because you can kind of, the same kind of verification you do at, say, unit test and system test, you can kind of distill that down to even kind of runtime checks to see, is this module really acting the way this module is supposed to act? And you could imagine even putting some machine learning on the side to look at the, it's a factory, look at this piece of the factory, what's the input, what's the output, and does it kind of look like, sheet metal's going in and cars are coming out, or very odd things coming out, the other end, right? So that's the kind of thing. But that's a little apple pie in motherhood. There's probably a whole generation of work on top of that. Okay. Well, thanks for coming today.